Pastor Scott is at a family getaway this weekend, and we wish him all the best. So he drafted me. Sorry. Some announcements this week. Our regular weekday meetings are continuing. We have our support group on Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock. Come and discuss what's on your heart and pray over that. And then on Thursday evenings, we have a viewing of The Chosen, Season 4, at 6:30. And that'll continue through the rest of the summer. Now, in September, once The Chosen is over, we will be restarting our Thursday afternoon Bible studies. And this year, we are doing a study on the harmony of the Gospels and the events of Jesus' lifetime. So wherever Jesus and his activities or things that happened to him show up in more than two or more Gospels, that's what we're going to be studying.
Nice.
I'm working on putting that together now. It's probably going to take most of the year. It'll be a fun one. I'm getting some ringing back here. Can you, like, turn off the monitor? There will be another women's gathering coming up in September on the 12th from 6 to 8. And that's a Thursday evening, and dinner will be provided. We had a women's gathering a couple of days ago, and we thought it was a good idea for some of the guys to get together. So I think we'll have a thing for the guys that same night. They'll probably be involved, like, you know, grilling meats and, you know, stuff like that. Encourage you to sign up for bringing cookies or snacks like we have back here today. And then a reminder that we are collecting supplies for Samaritan Purse Christmas boxes. So as you are out and find sales on school supplies, sandals, toys, or hygienic supplies, pick them up, bring them to the church, drop them off in the back here. And then come in November, there will be a pizza packing party of those shoe boxes. So I think that's all the announcements we have for this morning.
Shirley.
Shirley.
The women's thing is called Where Friends Meet, and we live at the hall.
It'll be at Township Hall?
It's at Township Hall.
Outstanding. Thank you. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for being here today, for giving us this wonderful fellowship of community in our church. Our wonderful island, your beautiful weather that you blessed us with today, and even if it's rainy, that's okay. We are forever grateful for all the gifts that you give us, especially the gift of your Son and the salvation offered through him, because you know we certainly can't earn it ourselves. And for that, we celebrate, and we are thankful, and we will sing to the greatness that you have given us. Amen.
Amen. I don't like people that make excuses for their actions, but not you, Greg, me. yesterday, we laid my oldest brother to rest in the great Lakeview Cemetery in Harbor Springs. And actually, two Fridays ago, the Lord called him home, and he obeyed. But, so, yesterday was very full of tears. All my family, I was so blessed to have them all around me and be together with them and celebrate my brother Dave's life. But I want you to know that I'm equally blessed today to have my chosen family around me. And thank you for being here. And so now, without further ado, come, now is the time to worship. This is one you know. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give my heart, your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. come. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. Come. Now this one was chosen by Greg, and I think it might be one of your favorites, right? Ancient Words. And I think we all know it. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Martyrs' blood stained the page. They have died for this faith. Hear them cry through the years. Heed these words and hold them dear. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart.
Okay, this one might be the clincher. I had a tough time practicing it this morning, so I'm going to really need your help. I don't know. You're right, Greg. Thank you for that. It's all my fault. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you'd say. So word of God, speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, and all that I need is to be with you. And in the quiet, hear your voice. So word of God, speak, here we go. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see? Thank you, Lord. Your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour out like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, word of God, speak. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Kirk's going to offer us a prayer.
You bow with me. Ancient words ever true, healing me and healing you. Lord, we come before you today because we need healing. Your word says if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and pray and turn from their wicked ways, And I will hear their prayers from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land. And Lord, we come with humble hearts today that we may hear your words. We may hear the word of God spoken into our hearts in a new and perhaps profound way, in a life-changing way. We ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit fill this place and change our hearts and change our minds, that we may truly repent and turn from our wicked ways, and that our land may be healed. Lord, we need healing in our families. We need healing in our homes. We need healing in our government. We need healing in our hearts. So, Lord, we offer up to you our gift of humble hearts today, and we pray that you would be pleased. In Jesus' name, amen.
The song says, I'm at a loss for words, and that's okay. So I know you guys would like that this morning. But Scott probably wouldn't appreciate that. He's not here. If you remember back to my last sermon, by the way, I'm Elder Greg Yarmoluk. I should have introduced myself right off the bat. And my last sermon, I talked about how Acts 17 contains a lot of great stuff, and that Paul's sermon to the Athenians has application both back in his time and to today. That song, Ancient Words, that was a reminder of that application. When I was in college, one of my favorite courses was called Ancient and Modern Problems. And it was taught by an emeritus professor of classical languages. And it looked at how Greek, Roman, and modern societies approach similar problems, whether it be government or infrastructure or the environment or war, politics. And I found it interesting in college and graduate school to take classes that were the special interest of scholars. And they'd spent years researching things. So what we're looking at right now with the book of Acts and with the Gospel of Luke is the special interest of a scholar. Luke was a doctor, likely a Greek, who converted to Christianity. Now, we don't know when Paul converted, how he met, or when Luke converted, when he met Paul, or when he started traveling with Paul. But we do know that Paul considered Luke to be beloved, agapitos in Colossians 4:14. So Luke likely wrote his gospel and the book of Acts while he was with Paul, while Paul was under house arrest in Rome. So let's jump into the story in Acts. And this is Paul's second missionary journey. It starts in Acts 16. And he starts over on the right side of the screen over in Antioch of Syria. He ventures up into modern-day Turkey. His hometown is Tarsus. And he's traveling with Silas, and he picks up along the way. He picks up Timothy and Luke. Now, somewhere along this trip in Turkey, Paul gets a call from the Holy Spirit, who says, I want you to go preach in Greece and Macedonia. So this is a big deal. I mean, Paul's first trip, he was spent in Cyprus and in what is now modern-day Turkey. And now the Holy Spirit's calling him to go preach really in the heart of the Gentile beast over in Europe. So they set sail from Troas, they land in Neapolis, you follow it there, and they end up in Philippi. Now, we talked last time a little bit about Philippi. They found Lydia and some other believers along a stream outside of town because there probably weren't 10 guys of Jewish a belief that could start a synagogue, and they started a small church there and of believers, and Luke probably remained behind at this time to help lead that church. So then they go on to Thessalonica, remember, and this is the beginning of chapter 17 now in Acts, and as usual, Paul creates, strife, raises the ire of the Jewish leadership there. Now, Paul regularly does this. I mean, he's famous. He's a famous Pharisee. He was known for persecuting the cult known as the Way. He had grown up in Tarsus, was sent away to school in Jerusalem to study under the famous Pharisee Gamaliel. But after he met Jesus on the road to Damascus, Paul suddenly started preaching a different message that really triggered the Jews. And he kind of had a three-part message. I mean, the first part was you need to repent of your sins. Well, the Jews could kind of handle that. But the second part of his message was that you must put your faith in Jesus Christ, who is our promised Messiah written about in Scripture, and who was raised from the dead. Well, as far as the Jewish leaders were concerned, that was three strikes and you're out for Paul there. I mean, that Jesus guy was just a blasphemer and a troublemaker. He obviously wasn't our promised Messiah because, hey, where's our warrior king that's going to defeat the Romans and we're going to live in peace again by ourselves and raising from the dead? No, 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 no. That was just a rumor. Now, the other problem that Paul had in his preaching was that he said that Gentiles were also called to be children of God. Well, that's like a fourth strike against him as far as the Jewish leaders were concerned. Because, you know, unless they were going to fully convert to Judaism and be circumcised and follow 613 laws, that wasn't going to happen. So as we talked about last time, Paul went on to Berea. And he really liked the Bereans because every time he and Silas preached, the Bereans would go back and look in the holy books and the scripture to verify what was being taught. But of course, Paul got in trouble again with the Jewish leadership that came in from Thessalonica. So he left Timothy and Silas there to help start up that church there in Berea. And with his escorts, he left and sailed around and ended up at Athens. And then he sent the escorts back and said, hey, send those two guys over here ASAP because I got stuff for them to do. So let's dive in to his visit to Athens, to his sermon and the results. And you can follow along in the Bibles on the table. In Acts 17:16 is where we're going to start. And people in the middle, grab a Bible off of one of the tables if you want, or you can just watch the screen. In the blue Bible, it starts on page 666. That's kind of ominous. in the large print brown Bibles, which, by the way, we just got some more of today, it's on page 1662. Now, these are New Living Translation Bibles on the tables. I'm going to be projecting NASB because that's Pastor Scott's favorite translation. But the real reason I'm going to project NASB is because it kind of keeps the same Greek sentence structure, and we're going to be popping up a few Greek words as we go through here. So let's pick up in verses 16 and 17. Now while Paul was waiting for them in Athens, his spirit was being provoked within him as he observed that the city was full of idols. So he was reasoning in the synagogue with the Jews and the God-fearing Gentiles, and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be present. So why did Paul stop and stay in Athens? I think God had a plan. You know, Athens was formerly the capital of the great Greek Empire. It had a population of over 300,000. But that was 400 years before Paul. You know, in the meantime, Greece had been conquered by the Romans in 156 BC, and Athens had a failed uprising against the Romans, you know, back in 88 BC. Greece was devastated, and economically and physically, but it was slowly on the road to recovery under the Romans. Now, Athens by now was a small university town. It was a Roman free city. And there were three free cities of known that were university towns. That was Athens, Tarsus, Paul's hometown, and Alexandria. Now, the population, when Paul came, was only about 10,000 people. That's like 3% of their previous population. However, there were 30,000 altars and idols scattered around Athens. The Roman satirist Petronius remarked, it was easier to find a god than a man in Athens. Now, Paul, being a Jewish Pharisee, yeah, he had an abhorrence to idol worship. And that's kind of summarized in 1 Peter 4:3. You've had enough for the past of evil things that godless people enjoy. Their immorality and lust, their feasting and drunkenness and wild parties, and their terrible worship of idols. So Paul's reaction to all these idols in Athens in verse 16 is in Greek a paroxenu, a paroxysm, an attack, a spasm, a seizure, maybe gagging. So, when you're out in society, when you're watching the news today, what things in society, what beliefs make you gag, make me gag? Abortion? Gender-altering child abuse? Human trafficking? Maybe political violence? Maybe politics in general? So does our reaction to these things inspire us to share the Word of God, like Paul does? You know, Paul, when he got to Athens, he followed his modus operandi. He went to the temple first, to the synagogue, and he preached that Jesus is the promised Messiah to the Jews and the God-fearing Gentiles in the temple. And then he stepped out and went into the marketplace, into the agora, with the same message. So are we willing to share God's word to those who oppose us, to those who don't believe in anything, to those who hate us? It's difficult. So let's remember Paul's advice in 2 Timothy in chapter 2. He starts in verse 23. Again, I say, I love this in the NLT, the way they put it. Again, I say, don't get involved in foolish, ignorant arguments that only start fights. A servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but must be kind to everyone. Be able to teach and be patient with difficult people. Gently instruct those who oppose the truth. Perhaps God will change those people's hearts and they will learn the truth. Then they will come to their senses and escape from the devil's trap, for they have been held captive by him to do whatever he wants. So kind of like the Cliff's Notes on that is, our job is to gently instruct. God's job is to change hearts. So let's pick up in verse 18. So Paul's out in the marketplace and he encounters some Epicurean and Stoic philosophers as well, and they were conversing with him. Some were saying, what could this scavenger of tidbits want to say? Others, he seems to be a proclaimer of strange deities because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. All right, now I'm going to go into the Greg interpretation of all of this. This is not, there are some people that don't see it this way, but this is the way I see this. This university town of Athens, think Ann Arbor. Yeah. Think Berkeley. Yeah. It's a countercultural city. There are two schools of intellectualism in this university town, and they looked down on organized religion. These were the Epicureans and the Stoics. Now, the Epicureans believed in the pursuit of pleasure as the highest goal. Now, this isn't hedonistic pleasure, but it's tranquility, without stress, without suffering, without pain. You know, they stressed the material world, kind of rejecting the spiritual. Now, they believed that the gods existed, but they were far away. They weren't involved at all in day-to-day life. So if we were to classify them, they would be like polytheistic deists. There's a bunch of gods, but they're not involved. And they also believe that religion is the root cause of all misery. Now, the Stoics, not too far off, they were founded by Zeno, who is from Paul's hometown of Tarsus. And they believed that matter was all that existed, but the divine spirit infused everybody and everything. So they were like pantheists, or maybe like the Force in Star Wars. And they emphasized ethics and reason and believed that all destiny was dictated by fate. So your goal was to achieve apathy towards whatever happened to you. Pleasure, pain, you know, just peacefully accept whatever came your way. Now, because the divine was in everybody, they believed, you know, in that brotherhood of mankind. Now, compare these intellectuals and their beliefs to what the mainstream religious belief was at the time. The belief in the Greek and Roman gods and their active involvement. You know, think of, you know, when on Paul's third trip to, for third missionary trip, he went to Ephesus, which was the town of the temple Artemis. And while he got a bunch of believers there, it ended up impacting the main business of the town, which was the tourism business and the idol-making business, to that great temple of Artemis, and they started, the trade union started a riot. You know, praise the great temple of Artemis, the great goddess Artemis. So these intellectuals in Athens, they looked down on Paul. They called him a spermalogos, a seed picker, or a scavenger bird. Different other explanations of that word. Someone who takes other people's ideas with, you know, out understanding them. You know, a plagiarist, an ignorant babbler. You know, plus it sounds like he's preaching false beliefs. He's talking about a god or gods, Jesus, resurrection. We don't believe in any of that stuff. Oh, by the way, preaching and introducing new religions, that's against the law. So, in our day-to-day lives, are we looked down upon by intellectuals? Are we ignorant Jesus freaks? People who just want to force our myths on others? God, creation, morality, patriarchy, judgment, sin, heaven and hell. You know, but before we respond, let's remember that quote from 2 Timothy. So let's jump back into verse 19. So these intellectuals, they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is which you are proclaiming? For you are bringing some strange things to our ears, so we want to know what these things mean." And then parenthetically, Luke adds, "Now all the Athenians and the strangers visiting were used to spend their time in nothing other than telling or hearing something new." Now, the Areopagus was both a location, literally meaning the hill of the god Ares, or you'll sometimes hear it referred to as Mars Hill, which is the Roman god, but it was also the name of a judicial council that met there, of about 30 members. And this council ruled on matters of homicide, deliberate homicide, or wounding, or on religious matters. You know, it was a criminal court that could impose sentences up to death. Now, Paul was invited, or perhaps commanded, we're not sure, to present his beliefs to this council of skeptics. Now, we don't know whether it was a trial type of situation, like a judgment or a court, or whether it was more of entertainment and ridicule. You know, think of an appearance on The View. So the Athenians, though they seem to spend a whole lot of time discussing these latest intellectual fads and trends and ideas, so, you know, perhaps they were projecting on Paul, calling him a seed picker, when they were the real seed pickers and babblers. You know, a popular online trend today in Christianity is called deconstruction. You know, where people are coached on how to deconstruct their faith, supposedly to get back to the roots of their beliefs. But what it really is, it's part of Marxist critical theory. You know, where the goal is not to reaffirm your faith, but to basically destroy your faith. As being, your faith is rooted in patriarchy and oppression. So on the sermon notes, I have a reference there, The Deconstruction of Christianity, the book, recent book by Alyssa Childers and Tim Barnett. Tim's a cool guy. He's Red Pen Logic with Mr. B, you'll find him. So jumping back into Acts in verse 22. So Paul, a little hot down here. So Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see that you are very religious in all respects. For while I was passing through and examining the objects of your worship, I also found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' Therefore, what you worship in ignorance, this I proclaim to you." You know, God gave Paul a gift to preach to a wide variety of audiences. You know, in 1 Corinthians 9, he talks about preaching the true gospel, but differently, to Jews or to Gentiles. So right here now, we're about to see Paul preach the same gospel, but tailored to an audience of intellectual Greeks. So we have a picture on the thing of the location of the Areopagus. Is that hill in the foreground? That's the Areopagus. That's the hill of Ares. And the whole group would, that council would meet on top of that hill. And Paul's standing on this hill. And in the background, you see the Acropolis with the great temple to the goddess Athena, which was the namesake of Athens. And all the glory of Athens' religious past spread out in front of him. So this is the background that Paul has as he's speaking. Now, he compliments this council. I'm going to put air quotes around the word compliments, because the word is that Luke uses as a mouthful, or Paul may have used, Desdemona Nesteros. It's usually translated as devout, but its range of meanings can be summarized as like more religious than the average bear, or quite superstitious, or to the Jews it would mean fear of the demonic. So this council now that's standing in judgment of Paul, they really don't consider themselves to be religious. I mean, they have a judgment, they're responsible for religious matters, but they don't consider themselves to be religious in the common form that those days, you know, because religion causes all the problems in the world. The Epicureans were polytheistic deists. The Stoics are pantheists. So Paul needs to proceed with care. He can't rely on Jewish scripture to preach the gospel, because that's a foreign belief, and that's illegal to do it that way. So he remembers that Athens has this large number of altars around the city that say that they are dedicated to an unknown god. Now, I've read that what they're there for is that in the ignorance of the people, if they forget to thank or praise some unknown god or goddess, that this would like avoid the wrath of that deity. So Paul would use this as a jumping off point to introduce the one true God, you know, to whom they were ignorant. You know, today, Christian apologists have been used to preaching against atheism, agnosticism, Satanism, Wicca. But what they're finding more and more is they're preaching against postmodernism. They're preaching against critical theory. And this is where logic, reason, objective truth, and knowledge, they're not acknowledged to be real things. They're acknowledged to be tools of oppression. There's no such thing as a truth. It's my truth. It's post-truth construction. You know, basically, it disrupts Western thought. And what happens is the apologists are now finding themselves allied at times with past atheists and agnostics who acknowledge that there are real truths, there is reason, there is logic, and these things aren't just social constructs used to oppress others. So if we jump back in at verse 24 for a few verses here, this is the fun part of Paul's sermon. So the God who made the world and everything that is in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made by hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation. So three short verses. Now in those three verses, Paul dismantles polytheism and pantheism. He dismantles temple worship and idols. He also dismantles the Athenian legend that their ancestors were born up out of the earth. They emerged from the earth like cicadas. Early Athenians used to wear golden cicada pins, and they called themselves the musical Athenians of the earth. Now, in the meantime, he also dismantles deism, in that the true God remains in control of all human activity. Now, in these days, some of the greatest evidence of God is found in the universe and the world around us. You know, our physics teacher friend, John Griefer, could tell you to the exact items of the creation of the universe and the orbits of the planets, how they all point directly to a creator. Life itself, the existence of it, and the complexity of it point directly to a creator. And no matter how old you think the earth is, there's simply not enough time or evidence for Darwinian macroevolution to be able to do the job, you know, to go from goo to zoo to you. So another book I cite there is Norm Geisler's and Frank Turek's, I don't have enough faith to be an atheist. So let's pick up in verse 27 what Paul says about man, what his role is, that they would seek God, if perhaps they might feel around for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and exist. And even some of your own poets have said, for we also are his descendants. Therefore, since we are the descendants of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by human skill and thought. So Paul now declares what our role is, to seek and find God. God's not far away, but within each of us. And he uses the example of, so you see how he's tailoring this, he uses the example of two Greek Stoic poets. The first is Epimenides, who is an early Greek philosopher poet, semi-mythical, and he quotes him as saying, for in him we live and move and exist. Or in another translation, in him we live and move and have our being. And then he quotes Aratus, who is a later Greek intellectual poet, for we are his offspring, or for we also are his dependents. So God is the one supreme being. He's not an idol created by man from precious metals or stone, but he's also not a concept created by man to be used for control and oppression. You know, people, one of the popular things now talks about people being wired to worship. You know, which kind of makes sense if you think about God as the creator programming us to seek him, to worship him, to align our lives to his will. You know, however, through sin and ignorance, we redirect that worship, or we allow others to redirect that worship. So we are worshiping things like worship nature that God created, or we worship a political or religious leader. You know, or we worship things that we create, or science, or we worship ourselves, or we worship our feelings or our lusts or our truths. So what are we to do next? Let's look in verse 30 and 31. So having overlooked the times of ignorance, God is now proclaiming to mankind that all people everywhere are to repent, because he has set a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness through a man whom he has appointed, having furnished proof to all people by raising him from the dead. So these members of the council are intellectuals, and they should now advance their beliefs, according to Paul, and their practices beyond ignorance. Metanoian is the word he uses here, to change one's mind, to repent. Now, God is forgiving if you repent from your sins and ignorant beliefs and you turn toward him. You know, this intellectual truth was as true for the Greeks as it is for us today. And this ignorant dogma that there's no absolute truth is totally anti-intellectual. You know, seeking truth where there are no truths is nonsensical. So why repent of your ignorant beliefs? You know, we kind of enjoy being back there, right? Well, Paul tells us there's a day of judgment by Jesus Christ who lived among us, who was killed and whom God raised from the dead to prove his authority. Well, this final judgment, afterlife, resurrection of Jesus, this was kind of all beyond the pale for these Greek intellectuals. I mean, the Epicureans believed mankind was moving toward extinction, you know, not eternal life. And the Stoics believed the atoms of the man would be absorbed into the cosmos. And there certainly wasn't any such thing as resurrection. I mean, the Greek playwright Aeschylus had long ago written that when the dust has soaked up a man's blood, once he is dead, there is no resurrection. When we look out in our modern society, what do we see? He who dies with the most toys wins. The boat dealer down south used to say, have bumper stickers, and said, life is short, boats are cool. We're going to be worm food, they tell us. There's no acknowledgement that we're eternal beings, either with or without God. So the reaction of this group, this august group of intellectuals, is what you would expect. Starting in verse 32, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some began to scoff, but others said, we shall hear from you again concerning this. So Paul went out from among them. So, you know, these Greek intellectuals, you know, they could stomach the interpretation of worshiping an unknown God as worshiping the unknown God, but to them it was an unprovable theory. It was just, you know, an intellectual exercise. However, when it came down to the verifiable proof, remember they're a court. So the verifiable proof that someone died and was resurrected, and that there were eyewitnesses that could be called before this court that saw this, that were with it, that were reputable eyewitnesses. Well, guess what? We couldn't accept that. We can't accept that. We can't discuss that. We can't even consider that. So the two major reactions were mockery and delay. They called him the seed picker, they ridiculed him, or they dismissed him with no real intention of hearing anymore. Which, gee, isn't that the same reaction we get to the gospel today? You know, mockery or the avoidance of any substantive discussion. You know, so it's easy if you could avoid talking about the message of the gospel, you know, and then remain in your ignorance. You know, Paul will later reflect that the world considers the gospel to be foolish. But to those whom God calls, the gospel is the power and wisdom of God. You know, 1 Corinthians 1, starting in verse 20, tells us, so where does this leave the philosophers, the scholars, and the world's brilliant debaters? You know, probably the Areopagus. You know, God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish, since God, in his wisdom, saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom. He has used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. It is foolish to the Jews who ask for signs from heaven, and it's foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended, and the Gentiles say it's all nonsense. But to those called by God to salvation, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. This foolish plan of God is wiser than the wisest of human plans, and God's weakness is stronger than the greatest of human strength. But verse 34 tells us that there were some believers. But some men joined him and believed, among whom were Dionysus, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. Now, this small number who believed, they weren't passive. The word Luke uses here is kolathentes, stuck to him like glue. And two of the noteworthy converts were Dionysus, who was a member of the Areopagus Council. Well, that was pretty unexpected. You know, and a woman named Damaris. Now, these were likely persons of renown who readers of Luke's account would have known. So, who's going to see our example? Who's going to hear our words and believe? You know, usually it's a small number. You know, some of the examples you can cite from recent times are people like George W. Bush, Kirk Cameron, supposedly Alice Cooper, and Bob Dylan. And one of the ones that always comes to my mind is C.S. Lewis, you know, an intellectual, agnostic at best, probably more atheist. But his fellow professor and a Catholic, J.R.R. Tolkien, of the Hobbit fame and Lord of the Rings, helped lead him to Christianity, to belief. So to wrap up with the first verse of chapter 18, after these events, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth. Now someone say, yeah, so it's a travelogue, right? But listen, this is one of the first times Paul leaves a city where he isn't violently thrown out of town. And while there weren't ever any recorded letters that Paul wrote to a church in Athens, you know, he left behind believers to work and live in a hostile environment. But they had the Word of God, they had the Holy Spirit, and they had the support of each other to help grow their numbers. You know, so Paul's following the instructions that Jesus gave us in the Great Commission at the end of Matthew. In Matthew 28, starting in verse 18, Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So is this Great Commission any different from Paul's time to ours today? You know, we're all called to respond, and these are right in the sermon notes. We're all called to respond to the culture around us in kindness, patience, gentleness, and the truth from 2 Timothy. You know, remembering that our job is to gently instruct, while it's God's job to change hearts. There are objective truths. In Christ, we have the essential truth. And the proof of this truth is all around us. It's not in some distant temple or idol. And the world will consider the gospel to be foolish. But to those called by God, it's the power and wisdom of God. And we have what we need in the Word, in the Holy Spirit, and in our fellow believers for support. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you really have given us all that we need. And the challenges faced by your early apostles and your early disciples of the church are the same ones we face today. The devil finds new ways to make it look different, but it's all the same. And so you've given us your word. You've given us the examples to follow. Your Holy Spirit remains with us to guide us, to help us in decision-making, to put words in our mouth when that needs to be there. And we have this wonderful family of believers around us to offer us support, to pray over us, to fill in where we may fall short, to provide the example for others to follow. And for all of that, we are eternally grateful. And help us continue to follow on the path that you've given us. Now and forever in Jesus' name. Amen.
Really, really good. Now you can breathe. It's the word. Okay, now this one might be one of my favorites. Thy word. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and I think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end. Unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word.
Thank you. So lucky.
Thank you, Facebookers and YouTubers. You can find us at www.lighthousechurchdrummondisland.com. Thanks for your prayers. give us your prayer requests or suggestions or questions about the sermon, that'd be fine. Pastor Scott will be back next Sunday, so you can be thankful for that too. So have a great week.
Thank you.
So now is our time of